So welcome to this episode of The Vote. It's a special vote to mark the coronavirus crisis. I'm here with Yael Breuer from Latest TV, of course, and we're going to be chatting through some of the issues, aren't we? We've been chatting backstage about some of the issues that have come up with our interviews and some of the issues that are relevant locally as well in Brighton and surrounding area.
Yeah, we thought it would be quite useful to kind of have an overview of the various aspects of the last few weeks, really, and for you mainly to talk about the different people that you spoke to and various trends that you might have discovered.
Exactly, yeah. I think, are we going to start off on healthcare?
Yeah, obviously the healthcare is the most important aspect of this whole period, and you know, the healthcare system has been under tremendous pressure nationally, probably not so much in Brighton, but you've spoken to some representatives of the healthcare.
Yeah, exactly. I think with healthcare, it's been, I think by and large, it seems that the city's coped fairly well in terms of the coronavirus cases. Don't think the hospital, Royal Sussex County Hospital, has been that overwhelmed so far. So the system seems to have been working. Also, at a local level, at Brighton Hove City Council, they seem to have coped pretty well as well. I'm hearing a lot that the officers there particularly have done a sterling work, you know, working 24/7 really, ensuring that people have the services that they need.
Okay, but if we start, you know, from the more or less top, if you like, you had a conversation with the former health minister.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, we've been kept updated by John Bowis, who's a former UK government health minister, and he's given some useful insights, really, particularly in terms of the way that the UK government has handled the crisis. And by and large, he's saying that they've done fairly well. I think where we've come unstuck in this country is testing. You know, testing's been a real issue, and I think it continues to be an issue throughout the country. It seems that we didn't have the kind of the procedures in place or the kind of the necessary infrastructure in place in time, really, to get a good testing regime rolled out. And I think if you compare it to, like, Germany, for example, you know, they're streets ahead, really. They have that testing infrastructure, that diagnostic capability, which maybe the UK's lacked.
I mean, the testing element is so important. When you think about it, healthcare professionals have not been tested.
Yes.
These are the people who treat people who are either, you know, ill or showing symptoms or coming for various other reasons and to various other parts of hospitals. So the fact that testing has been lacking is shocking, really.
It does seem that way, yeah, it does, because the thing is, there's healthcare workers that could be out in the workforce in the hospitals, care homes, but because they haven't been tested, they can't risk that, and that means that, you know, there's quite a lot of absenteeism in hospitals and care home settings, and that could have been much reduced if these people had been tested, so they get the green light to re-enter the workforce.
I know. Yeah. I mean, a big part of the discussion about healthcare is unfortunately bereavement.
Yes.
And what happens when things go, you know, sadly wrong. You've spoken to a couple of people who are experts on the subject. Do you want to elaborate a little bit?
Exactly. I mean, Jane Cato, who's head of bereavement and counselling at the Martlets Hospice, which does great work in the city, and we've featured them on the Latest TV before. She was talking about, you know, the transition from having face-to-face consultations to that online consultation, which everyone's now working online, but particularly for bereavement and counselling, that makes it particularly difficult, because someone that is seeking out bereavement counselling, they might want that kind of that face-to-face interaction.
And then the most important, I think, aspect of bereavement is the ability to speak and be with other members of family or close friends. And this is something that's been taken away from people. This is a basic element of healing in the bereavement period. And, I mean, this must have been so difficult for so many people.
Exactly. I think even in wartime, you know, people go to a funeral, don't they? So do you think, like, what's the most extreme thing? Well, probably a war for a lot of people, and people can attend someone else's funeral. But because of that social distancing necessity, people aren't able to go to their loved one's funeral, which is just unthinkable. You would never think that we'd even be talking about this a few months ago. And that that's a big marker of you know, the times we're in. You know,
absolutely,
we're in really
of this specific time.
Exactly.
Well, we can't not mention, you know, under the topic of the healthcare system, the enormous appreciation that everybody has for the healthcare workers. And those, you know, Thursday night clappings,
yes.
I know it's a small gesture, yeah. And I know it's not going to solve anything and it's not going to bring equipment, but it is, I find it really quite powerful and emotional.
Yeah, exactly. In Brighton, we've been doing it in our own unique way as well. I mean, one of my neighbours got out a drum kit and started banging the drum, which was really quite funny, actually, as well as, touching. It was it's funny. Yeah. And so... every street's got their own unique way of celebrating the NHS. They've done great work in our city. My sister's a paramedic, so I know they're really on the front line and they're putting their lives on the line in many ways as well. And that's really
Absolutely.
Got to be appreciated. And what better way to do it, to meet your neighbours and clap at the same time.
Mm.
We're all getting to know our neighbours as well, aren't we, through that process? Which
yes, absolutely.
Which is great as well.
Which is great. So. Yeah. I mean, moving from the very important aspect of our healthcare to perhaps slightly more mundane aspects of daily, everyday life, our everyday life has been impacted in so many ways. Maybe let's just mention some of them. I mean, starting with the workplace.
Yeah.
So we know the economy has and probably will continue to suffer. But a lot of people have got used to working from home. I mean, we at Latest TV have been working as a
yeah.
very small team.
We're a bit further apart.
A bit further apart, yeah. Lots of Skype interviews.
Yes.
Have you spoken to people who perhaps disclose what it was like for them to, in terms of being part of a workforce that's very different?
Yeah, I mean, you know, Olivia Marshall from Latest TV, she's spoken to businesses, local businesses in the past about how they're dealing with it. You know, you have to get an infrastructure in place in order to kind of work remotely in some instances in some businesses, because they're not used to doing it. Some people are just stuck in their old ways, as people do. And so you kind of have to set up a whole like Skype for Business infrastructure, for example, get that on board. You have to kind of, you know, when you have a meeting online, it is different to meeting someone in person. So you kind of have to be a bit more organised. You have to think about the whole way you kind of conduct a meeting. I mean, do it online, and that takes a long time for some companies to get used to that. But I think some people will continue to work at home because people are paying rental costs. And I've spoke to Gavin Stewart from Brilliant Brighton about this as well. Yeah, people are paying rental costs in offices, and they're now thinking, well, hang on a minute.
Yes.
Half my workforce.
Yes.
Can work remotely. Do I need the same office space? And that's why I think that you were talking about lifestyles, but I think the whole way we think about work will definitely change.
Definitely.
Maybe that long commute from Brighton to Victoria Station, you know, Westminster, maybe that wasn't so worth it. Maybe you could do half that job at home and not do so much commuting. So
there's no doubt. And yeah. In the education sector as well, I'm sure that things will be rethought even when this period finishes in terms of electronic delivery of services. Well, we apart from people who work from home, it's those who have to stay at home. And there've been a lot of people who are self-isolating or self-quarantined. You've spoken to quite a few of them, and on a regular basis to a couple of our own presenters. A lot of people have been very positive in the circumstances, and obviously other people have found it harder. I guess it depends on the kind of infrastructure that people have in their own homes.
Exactly, yeah. And also, you know, small things like, you know, how much broadband width you've got, can you do a Skype call? It's kind of quite, it's interesting really, or finding the perfect setting to do a call, Skype call. I've noticed, we're seeing a lot of people's houses, aren't we? Their background and
yes.
their kind of bookshelf. We're seeing a lot of different bookshelves.
It's a bit like going onto the artist's homes in open houses just to have a look at someone's house. It's quite similar. You kind of look around and say, oh, that's a horrible picture. What's that wallpaper doing in that person's house?
So it is totally different. And we're going to be talking a bit about, in the second half, we're going to be talking a bit about how else our lives have changed, including that social distancing, because everyone's getting a bit awkward in supermarkets, aren't they, with the social distancing, and we're learning new ways to interact with each other. So join us for the second half. Yael and I, we're going to be talking a lot more about how the coronavirus crisis has impacted our city in the second half. So join us then.
remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
Welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Yael Breuer from Latest TV. A special episode of The Vote. We're going to be looking through those more of those interviews and those issues that have cropped up through this crisis, which we're still moving through. Social distancing. How's it for you, Yael?
Do you know, it's probably something that I will always, for the rest of my life, think about. I think even when this finishes, because it's not something that I've ever obviously thought about doing, but you know, I see people, and it's happened to me that people kind of say, you know, keep your distance in the supermarket, even when you walk in the street. A friend of mine actually recently said to me, can you ever imagine you being in a social function again, in a crowded social function again? And I said, yes, I can, but I think it is something that's going to stay in our in our minds.
And I'll never forget that when Boris Johnson, Prime Minister, when he said, you know, all bars are closed tonight, and it was like, I was gobsmacked, really. Right. I mean, because I kind of saw it coming, but to actually be told that, obviously here at Latest Music Bar, we had to shut as well. We were thinking of shutting anyway. I think people had a warning, but for the Prime Minister to actually say that, I'll never forget that, I don't think. And a lot of people...
And this, like a few other aspects of this particular time, are very unique. I mean, this time has been compared to some elements of Britain in the Second World War.
Yes.
And I can see why. But yes, there are things that are just, you know, have never been experienced before. And this kind of strict social distancing, which is a very important aspect of it. Yeah. It is a strange one.
And we've had to learn to be patient, you know, which doesn't come to me too easily all the time. But you have to. We're all learning how to be patient. Maybe we're listening a bit more, which is probably a good thing. Mentioned it first off about knowing our neighbours, and hopefully that's one of the things I hope does carry through. Me and my wife, Angie, Mariana, we've always tried to get on with our neighbours and get to know them. And it's
so
interesting.
So you're managing to now, from a distance.
Yeah, from a distance. And it's a good thing to know your neighbours. And, you know, there's lots of benefits to that, isn't there? So that's a good thing. And
that brings me to discussions kind of from foreign lands. We have had interviews with people from other countries, including on our program covering COVID-19, where we look at local communities in this country and abroad. And we've recently had an interview with a journalist from France who was talking about, which I was surprised about, the sort of French way of not taking community initiatives and waiting for the kind of authority to come with instructions and then follow the instructions. And if there's a problem with that, basically not kind of improvise, and that's not the British way, is it? There's been so much community effort and individuals just taking initiatives. It's been incredible in this respect.
Yeah, it has. And most people are following those rules. There might be a bit of deviation. You might be doing, you know, two walks, not the one, or going slightly a bit longer. But by and large, I think, particularly groups of people, I don't see groups of more than two, which is what the police and the authorities are really worried about, you know, big groups of people. And that I don't see that happening, really, particularly from what I can see. I'm obviously, you know, not there everywhere all the time, but from what I can see, that seems to be being followed, which is really important.
Yeah, so people, by and large, follow rules, but also taking initiative, which I think is a good combination. So that sounds like we're kind of moving to maybe discussing other positives that may come out of this extremely difficult time. Yeah. What kind of impressions have you had from people that you've interviewed about positive outcomes?
I think we've been following closely the Clapping for Carers initiative. So Olivia Marshall's been speaking to a lot of people in the community. She went to a Molscombe area. She worked with the Acorn Renters Union, and they're doing a really good initiative. around communities where they're looking after the vulnerable, asking them if they need maybe a prescription or a food delivery or just checking on their general well-being. Dr. Andrea Brock as well from the Brighton Mutual Aid. She's featured a lot on latest TV news. And the whole mutual aid groups are in and around our city are doing really well. And
That's great.
I know that, you know, Nancy Platts, leader of the Brighton Hove City Council, and Lloyd Russell Moore, the MP for Brighton Kempton, they've also been on latest TV news and said how that grateful they are. But we've needed that community infrastructure to carry us through to where we are at the moment, and that needs to continue in the following weeks.
And it's important to mention creativity, because musicians, performers, a lot of people with the Brighton Festival, Brighton Fringe, have had to be cancelled or postponed. So all these people are actually stuck in their homes without the ability to express their creativity and earn money while doing so.
Yeah.
It's been horrendous. However, a lot of people have come up with, amazing creative ideas of expressing,
yes,
their abilities to perform, to sing, to write, to recite poetry. It's all over social media, and we've been showing quite a lot of it on covering COVID-19 program.
Yeah, exactly.
It's been great to watch these people.
Helena Shepherd, who I think's got a big following now, even bigger than before, right?
Yeah, so she runs choirs in Russian and in Yiddish, and she now has people joining her from literally all over the world every day.
Yeah, we heard from Tamsin Sasha as well, reciting Greek poetry online, which is really good, actually, because you can feel the passion and the emotions,
yes,
even through a computer screen when you're listening to
it. Absolutely,
YouTube,
and Henry Normal. I mean, there are so many fantastic people.
Yeah.
Let's talk a little bit about what might come next.
Yes, exactly. Because I think the big question people are asking at the moment is, when will lockdown end? The new Labour leader, Keir Starmer, he's been asking that. One of the first things he says is maybe we don't end social distancing now with a lockdown, but we need an exit strategy, so people need some kind of certainty.
Because it's not going to happen in a day, is it?
No.
Going back to normality. It can't anyway, but even if, let's say that by a miracle we had the ability to transform all kind of systems back to normality in a day, which we obviously can't, our psyche wouldn't allow that. Things will be very gradual and different.
I think the way I see it, I think the way that the government's maybe see it as well. Like, we don't know completely what they're thinking, because obviously Boris Johnson, the Prime Minister, is still recuperating, having had coronavirus. So, I think that it will be gradual. Maybe small shops open up first, maybe with some social distancing measures. Maybe schools open up before we know it. Maybe middle of May, early May, who knows. Maybe, adults here, because obviously the schools, I think if the schools go back a bit earlier than what we think, maybe then some workers can, they can go back out into the workforce.
Yeah, so, on a gradual.
So there is, I think there is scope for that. And I think that's what's happening elsewhere, because we've seen through the COVID programme what's happening in Spain, in Italy, up in Norway. And it seems that the schools are going back before. They're one of the first things that we see is that schools going back to how they were.
And I think there'll be discussions. Do you realise we will be in history books? People will, from all disciplines, academic disciplines, will look at this time and will examine, how we did. So there'll be questions. There'll be a lot of discussions and questions to ask from now onwards by us as well, and our leaders and our systems, whether the right thing has been done, whether the right approach has been taken. And every country has behaved a little bit differently, but every country will, think things through, and I hope we'll learn some lessons.
Yeah, and also I think one of the big things we've learned is obviously the UK's just left the EU, but we also need to act.
Gosh, I forgot about that.
Exactly. I mean, who would have thought that? Brexit was a big issue, and now, this is like so much bigger. I think everyone's learning that whatever happens in the future, we need to cooperate, work together, because the solution to coronavirus is going to be a global solution. It's not going to be, it's not going to be one person acting alone. It's going to be lots of people acting together to find a vaccine for the virus and other measures, maybe antibody tests, more testing. All of that, it requires a coordinated approach, and that's why the NHS has done so well, and proven its worth, because we've got a national approach to healthcare through the NHS, through NHS Scotland, through the other NHSs in Northern Ireland and Wales, and that, you know, it's that kind of national approach which is getting us through the crisis and everyone cooperating and working together.
Yeah, but and as you say, Britain has moved, you know, out of the European Union. And ironically, each country has been on its own up until now, but international cooperations have taken place.
Yes.
And will have to take place. And really and truly, we were all in this together. The whole world has been in this together. And it may happen again. Well, people did say, you know, important people said, you know, years ago that this may happen. Probably didn't get taken so seriously.
Yeah.
Maybe from now on a national and international level, people will be thinking, you know, more seriously about the possibility, the nasty possibility, but realistic possibility that these things may be part of the way the world goes.
Yeah. Bill Gates, 2015, he said that one of the greatest global threats wasn't a war, it's actually a global pandemic. And I think he might have been
said
right.
Exactly that.
Yeah.
Barack Obama said that. You know, important, influential people have taken... have said these things.
OK, we'll leave it there. Yael, as always, a pleasure. That was the vote. Join us regularly to watch the vote and other programmes on Latest TV. But that's it for now. Stay safe and stay at home.